Christy Rangel, and I'm here with your announcements. Our annual school supply drive benefiting Broadmoor Elementary is still going on. We are collecting items such as number two pencils, scissors, and composition notebooks. You can see a complete list on the screen. Please donate your items on Sundays in Connection Cafe in the red buckets through July 31st. Join your friends next Wednesday at the Holy Child Luncheon in the Casual Worship Center at 12 o'clock. It's only $5 payable at the door, but we do ask you to RSVP. You can RSVP today online at our website or outside the Sanctuary or Connection Cafe. Be More Supper Clubs are launching this fall. If you've been at Broadmoor a while, you know we did this in the past and we're bringing it back. This is a great way to meet new people, strengthen ties with people you already know, and share a good meal. Groups will consist of 6 to 8 people and will meet once a month through November. Go to our website, broadmoormethodist.org, for all the details and to complete a short survey to sign up. If you have any questions about these announcements or anything else happening at Broadmoor, please come to Connection Cafe or go to our website, broadmoormethodist.org. You can also sign up for our weekly emails in Connection Cafe. I hope you all have a great week.
Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Welcome to the sanctuary service of Broadmoor United Methodist Church in Baton Rouge, Louisiana. We're so grateful that you have chosen to worship with us today. As we prepare our hearts for worship, allow our pre-service music to lift your spirits and then join in our opening hymn.
And now we will be singing the hymn that you just heard played. The words are really a prayer to the Lord of love, seeking to be taught how to love each other. May that truly be our desire.
Joyful, joyful, we adore thee, God of glory, Lord of love. Hearts unfold like flowers before thee, opening to the sun above. love. Melt the clouds of sin and sadness. Drive the dark of doubt away. Giver of immortal gladness, fill us with the light of day. Thou art giving and forgiving, ever blessing, ever blessed. Wellspring of the joy of living, ocean depth of happy rest. Thou our Father, Christ our brother, all who live in love are thine. Teach us how to love each other, lift us to the joy divine. Mortals, join the mighty chorus which the morning stars began. Love divine is reigning o'er us, binding all within its span. Ever singing, march we onward, victors in the midst of strife. Joyful music leads us onward in the triumph song of life.
As a sign of our unity and love for one another, let us affirm our faith with the words of the Apostles' Creed, followed by the ancient hymn of faith, the Gloria Patri. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead and ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. Amen.
Will you join with me in prayer? Almighty and gracious God, we give you thanks for the gift of this day. We give you thanks for all your goodness and loving kindness to us and to all that you have made. We ask, O Lord, that in this time of worship, you will help our hearts draw near to you, and that we will experience your peace, your presence, and your power. Gracious God, we lift up to you all of those in our world who are hurting, and we ask that you would give us eyes to see and hands ready to help those in need. For we know whatever we have done for the least of these, we have done also for you. Give us generous hearts, O God, and help us to shine your light into the world. Be with us and those we love. Keep us safe and show us the way that leads to life. For we pray in the name of your Son, Jesus. Amen.
And now let us pray together the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Today, we're going to continue our sermon series, I Am. And we're going to be looking at a passage from the Gospel of John. It's in chapter 11. It's verses 24 through 27, where Jesus says, I am the resurrection and I am life. He says this just before he's going to be crucified. And he says these words when he's dealing with the death of his friend Lazarus. Y'all all know the story of Lazarus, right? Lazarus is a brother of Mary and Martha. He's a good friend of Jesus. He gets sick not 2 miles from where Jesus is. And they send word for Jesus to come and heal him. And Jesus doesn't go. Some say it's because of the Jews that threatened to kill him for his teaching and healing. And he waits 3 days to go where Lazarus is. He gets there. And Lazarus is already in the tomb for 4 days. And Jesus weeps for his friend. Martha, the sister of Lazarus and the follower of Jesus, says, Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. And Jesus says to her, your brother will rise again. Here's the passage. Martha said to him, I know that he will rise again in the resurrection on the last day. Jesus said to her, I am the resurrection and the life. Those who believe in me, even though they die, will live. And whoever lives and believes in me will never die. Do you believe this? See, I want to stop here and ask you, do you believe this? I did 3 funerals this week, and in every one, I start out by quoting this verse. Jesus said, I am the resurrection and I am life. Sometimes I think I should add, do you believe this? You know, doing a funeral for someone who believes this is an easy thing to do. Bill Oliver, Carolyn Lance, Claudia Domain, Chuck Anderson, Rosemary Pilla, Travis Nichols, Polly Williams, Merlin Thorne, Jewel Scruggs, Hank Van Dieven, Jane Oliver. I could go on and on and on naming people whose funeral it was easy for me to preach because they believed this, that Jesus was the resurrection and the life and that everyone who believes in him will never die. Our Easter service always has that responsive reading, right? Where the pastor says, Christ is risen. And the congregation says, he's risen indeed. And we say that with fervor. He's risen indeed. Do you believe this? This one verse is really the foundation of our faith. Do you believe this? As we get more and more sophisticated and educated, we run the risk of forgetting that. Our faith becomes based upon Jesus being a good person and setting an example of how we should live, caring for people, loving for people, and trying to be like him. But the foundation of our faith is, I am the resurrection and I am life. I think we should say it every Sunday. Christ is risen. He's risen indeed. We should greet each other with Christ is risen. And the response should be, he's risen indeed. What I've found interesting is that throughout the entirety of the New Testament, we find absolutely no lengthy debate or defense given for this proclamation. The fact that Jesus rose on the 3rd day was accepted by all of his followers as the truth. See, this is the capstone. It's the cornerstone of our faith. And the Apostle Paul makes it clear in Corinthians when he writes, and if Christ is not risen, then our preaching is empty and your faith is also empty. Yes, we are found false witnesses of God because we have testified of God that he has raised up Christ. For if the dead do not rise, then Christ is not risen. And if Christ is not risen, your faith is futile. You are still in your sins. Then also those who have fallen asleep in Christ have perished. Now, Paul wasn't defending the resurrection. He was simply speaking about its truthfulness. Unfortunately, many folks today don't take the time or the energy or study to find this out for themselves. They're too intellectual to believe that anybody could be resurrected and provided life to us. Atheists and agnostics, they're too smart to have faith or to believe that there's anything greater than themselves. You can try to discuss it with them, but they have their minds made up by other critics. Having listened to the critics and not checking their stories or their speaking points. They don't want to be bothered with the idea of something greater and go about their lives trying to fill it up with meaninglessness. They say, I'm going to live life to the fullest. One person who did check it out was Josh McDowell. McDowell was a pre-law student. He considered himself an agnostic. He believed that Christianity was worthless. However, when he was challenged by his Christian friends on campus to prove them wrong, he undertook the challenge. And through his study, he found overwhelming evidence for the Christian faith. He studied the documents that he found in the Old and the New Testament, and he realized they were the most reliable writings in antiquity. When asked why he couldn't disprove Christianity, he responded with this: for the simple reason that I was unable to explain away the fact that the resurrection of Jesus Christ was real, it was a real event in history. Afterwards, he authored a lot of books: Evidence That Demands a Verdict, More Evidence That Demands a Verdict, More Than a Carpenter, and Daniel in the Lion's Den. I could go on and on with people who had similar experiences like Josh McDowell. But let's look at some other evidence. The first is this: if the writers of the Bible truly wanted their audience to believe what they said, that what they said was really the truth, they would never have used women as witnesses to the resurrection story. You remember who the first witnesses were, right? They were women. They were going to the tomb to anoint the body of Jesus. It was women that were first to witness the resurrection. Back in those days, women were never called as witnesses because they were considered, unfairly, mind you, unreliable. And so using them as the focal point of the resurrection story reveals that the writers were more interested in the truth than in trying to convince anyone. The gospel writers all point to the women at the tomb, their encounter with the angels and the resurrected Christ. If they wanted to be more legalistic, they would have relied on the testimony of men. But they told the story as it happened, using women as the first witnesses of the resurrected Christ. The writers were more interested in telling the truth than in trying to make some case or legalistic argument for the resurrection of Christ. Next, consider what Thomas said. Once he touched the hands and the feet and the side of Jesus in the upper room. Do you remember this? Thomas wasn't there the first time Jesus appeared to the disciples in the upper room. And he tells the disciples, I won't believe until I feel the wounds in his hands and his feet. And here's what is said during his encounter with Christ, when he finally meets Christ in the upper room. Jesus said, don't be unbelieving, but believing. To which Thomas replied, my Lord and my God. And here's the point. No good Jew would ever use these words, my Lord and my God, to anyone, because they would have been considered blasphemous. And if you're witnessing to a Jewish person, this is not a story you would tell, because they would immediately stop listening. As a Jew, you don't tell people you called anyone Lord or God, because that would be blasphemous and a sin. You didn't utter God's name. But again, the writers of the New Testament were more concerned about accurately putting down what happened rather than worry about what others might think. So they wrote exactly what Thomas said, my Lord and my God. And the third thing I'd like to point out is how the disciples died. If they knew that Jesus really didn't rise from the dead, and the tomb wasn't empty, why would they submit themselves to persecution and death? The horrifying torture they went through. Why not just say, we were lying, and be done with it? Why not say, well, you know, we had a good run. Got some pretty good stuff. Got a lot of folks to shout Hosanna. Got to see a lot of miracles. Drank some great wine that Jesus made from the water. Got to see him walk on the water, calm the storm. But you know what? That resurrection thing, that's all a lie. So don't kill us. We'll shut up about it. That's not how it went down. Remember the passage in Romans where Peter and John are brought before the Jewish leaders in the book of Acts? The high priest, the Sanhedrin, arrest them, and they put them in jail because they were proclaiming the resurrection of Jesus. And the leaders were bringing them to trial. These are the same guys that had Jesus brought before Pilate and had him beaten and crucified. Peter and John were put on trial just like Christ. They knew what they were facing. And here's what they said in Acts chapter 4. But Peter and John replied, "Judge for yourselves whether it's right in God's sight to listen to you rather than God. For we cannot stop speaking about what we have seen and heard." Does that sound like someone who's lying about something? They're literally facing torture and death. The same torture and death that they watched Christ go through. They were willing to die for the truth rather than live and deny what they knew to be true. And then there's changed lives. The most telling of all proofs is the changed lives of those early Christians. They weren't given great rewards and prestige and power, but instead they were beaten. They were stoned. They were tortured. They were thrown to the lions. They were crucified. The disciples radically changed from cowering men in the upper room to bearing fearless witness in the face of death. We also see Saul of Tarsus, whose name was changed to the Apostle Paul. His life was radically changed after his encounter with the risen Christ. He went from being a persecutor of Christians to being a believer and a missionary for the very one, Jesus Christ, who he was originally adamantly against. But then there's our own lives and how we've changed. This is probably the strongest evidence of the resurrection. It was something that stood out to Josh McDowell. Josh talked about a small group of people, including a couple of professors, whose lives were different. Not in a weird way. They were different because of the love they showed not only towards each other, but for others. And that's what he wanted, so he made friends with them. And the rest is history. Josh started out wanting to prove these believers were wrong, and after coming into contact with him, he wanted some of what they had. As believers in the resurrection, that is the best thing we can do. To live lives of love that make people want to have what we have. Y'all know people whose lives were changed dramatically through the belief in the resurrection. One of our ministers that used to be here was Pete Spitzgeit. I love Pete. He was a missionary in Korea. And that was a tough missionary place because they had other religions, and it was a very patriarchal society when he was there, especially and the grandfather and the father kind of decided what the religions were going to be. And Pete related a story about a young woman who was married and living in her husband's house with the grandfather, and she came to Christ. And it was a problem because the family wasn't Christian, but she kept coming to church. And she kept doing what Christ does. She kept loving. And Pete said, right before it was time for him to come back to the United States, the grandfather That young lady's father-in-law walked down the aisle of his church and accepted Christ. Pete said, I had talked to him about Christ multiple times, trying to get him to convert. He walked down the aisle, and after he had baptized him and had him become a member, Pete said, what changed your mind? What struck a chord with you? He said, I've watched my daughter-in-law and how she lived, what she does, and I want some of that. See, the resurrection brings a newness of both life and hope, because when Jesus rose from the dead, when he exited the tomb, an entirely new era dawned on the earth. So we can say, Christ is risen. He's risen indeed. And we can say that he lives. And this brings me to the last aspect of the resurrection that I want to share with you. The resurrection guarantees our resurrection. I like to go back to what Jesus said to Martha at Lazarus' resurrection. He said, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me, though he may die, shall live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. Do you believe this? Basically, Jesus was saying that he was the resurrection and the life, and if we want to live eternally and never die and not perish for all eternity, that comes through the belief in him. This is not the only time Jesus said something like this to his disciples to give them the same resurrection and hope of heaven. He said this, let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house there are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself, that where I am, there you may be also. With this resurrection faith in our hearts, we don't have to despair. When our lives here on the earth come to an end, when we believe in Jesus' resurrection from the dead, not only will we be saved, but it guarantees our resurrection as well. When we believe, we move from eternal death into eternal life, knowing that our sins are nailed to the cross, and that Jesus rose from the grave, and that he is our living Savior and not some dead deceiver. We can, with all confidence, believe that the grave is not the end of life. Death is now only a change in our living conditions. Because of that, whatever problems and troubles we have, whether they're financial or relational or health related, we can confidently lay them at the foot of the cross. And we can come to the empty tomb where the stone was rolled away and know that our sins are forgiven and that death no longer has any power over us. And there we will find not only the newness of life, but the assurance of our salvation and eternal life in heaven with him. We can shout it at the top of our lungs. Christ is risen. He's risen indeed. We can believe this. Let's pray. Father God, I thank you for the resurrection life, for the opportunity to be with you in eternity. I thank you for the gift of your Son. Thank you for allowing us to be resurrected with him. It's in Jesus' name that I pray. Amen.
Love divine, all loves excelling, joy of heaven to earth.
Jesus, thou art all compassion, pure unbounded love thou art. Visit us with thy salvation, enter every trembling heart. Come, Almighty, to deliver, let us all thy life receive. Suddenly return and never, never more thy temples leave. Thee we would be always blessing, serve thee as thy hosts above. Pray and praise thee without ceasing, glory in thy perfect love. Finish then thy new creation, pure and spotless let us be. Let us see thy great salvation, perfectly restored in thee, changed from glory into glory, till in heaven we take our place, till we cast our crowns before thee, lost in wonder, love, and
in just a minute, we will conclude our time together with our benediction song, but right now I encourage you to watch this brief video on ways that you can give to the ministry of our church.
There are many ways that you can give toward the mission of Broadmoor. You can go to broadmoormethodist.org/giving to give safely and securely online. You can text BEMORE to 73256. And of course, you can also mail checks to our physical address at 10230 Molly Lee Drive, Baton Rouge, Louisiana, 70815.
My friends, may you grow in and in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior. My friends, may you grow in grace and in the knowledge of Jesus Christ. To God be the glory, now and forever, amen. To God be the glory, now and forever.